So guys, hi everybody. Let's start with our webinar. Now, just a second guys. I request you to disable your video for videos please. All right, guys. So I'm Professor Sandeep Gupta, and on behalf of my team, that is Agarwal Education Center, I welcome you all to Engineering Admissions Counseling Seminar 2021. Now, although I am the speaker in this particular seminar, but I am being held by my team. So now let me give you a brief introduction of my team. So guys, here we have Professor Ram Kumar Agarwal. So Ram Kumar Agarwal is a very famous name for mechanics in Western suburbs. Then we have Professor Vinayak Kulkarni, who is teaching maths on to engineering students as well as on 12th standard level. Then that's Professor SK. Professor SK teaches BEE, and he's a faculty in a very reputed college in Mumbai. Unfortunately, I cannot take the name of the college over here, but if you ask me on a one-to-one level, I'll let you know. Then that's me. I'm Professor Sandeep Gupta. I have been teaching programming subjects to students since last 15 years or even more than that. In your second semester, you have a subject called C programming, which I'll be teaching. Apart from that, I teach many other programming subjects. So if you are in computer, if you're going to take computers or IT, then I'll be teaching you programming even in your higher semesters. Otherwise, for all the students, I'll be teaching C programming in semester two. I hope you know that no matter which branch you take, the subjects are going to remain same in semester one as well as semester two. Now we have Professor Sanjay. Professor Sanjay basically teaches engineering graphics. So this is a subject of your semester two. Now I'll request you that you take a screenshot of this particular pamphlet. So it will be useful to you later on. We have our fee structure also over here and our phone numbers in case you need them. Okay, so I'll just pause the video for a few seconds. And if you want, you can take a screenshot of this if you wish to. All right, now let's move further. So guys, when you're sitting for this seminar, I want you all to sit over here with a positive mindset. And that positive mindset is that, if you want to get into engineering, you will get into engineering. Yes, you heard it right, guys. If you want to get into engineering, you will get into engineering at any cost, no matter what marks you have, what score you have. So the moment I say this, the next question in your mind could be that if I'm going to get into engineering at any cost, then why I should attend this webinar? So the main purpose of attending this webinar is to understand the admission process. But more than that, the main purpose of attending this webinar is to optimize your chances of getting into a better engineering college. Yes. So with whatever score you have, you should basically get into a better college than you were supposed to get. So in this particular webinar, we are going to give you certain tricks, certain techniques. And if you implement those simple tricks and techniques, then trust me, guys, you are going to get into a better college. Now, let's start with some basic stuff. So first of all, we'll talk about the rules, which are of this year or previous year. Before I move ahead, guys, I want to tell you one thing over here, that whatever I'm going to tell you today, all these things are based on the rules of the previous year. Now, let me elaborate a little on this. See, what happens is your admission process will be carried out by DTE, that is Directorate of Technical Education. Now, every year DTE is going to issue some, every year the DTE will issue some guidelines. And on the basis of these guidelines, the admission process is carried out. Now, what happens is there are some rules which change from year to year. So there could be certain rule which was applicable last year, but it is not applicable this year. Now, we waited all this time to conduct this webinar because we were waiting for the new rules of the DTE. But unfortunately, as expected, the DTE has not yet issued the new rules. So what
are the new rules?
Okay, some disturbance in between. So what I was saying is that whatever rules I'm telling you, okay, these are rules of the previous year. Okay, as and when the rules are changing, I'll keep you updated if you are in the WhatsApp group which we have formed. Okay, most of the rules will remain same, but some of them may change. Now let's understand what is the eligibility criteria to take admission in an engineering college of Maharashtra. So if you want to take admission in an engineering college of Maharashtra, then there are three conditions which you should fulfill. Condition number one is that you should be an Indian national. Condition number two is that your aggregate in physics, maths, and a third subject should be 45%. And condition number three is that you should have a non-zero score in CET or JEE mains. I assume that in JEE mains, you even have negative marking. So when I say non-zero, then in JEE mains, you should have a positive score. And in CET also, you should have a positive score. That positive score can be anything above zero. So these are the three conditions: Indian national, minimum aggregate percentage 45% in physics, maths, and a third subject, and a non-zero score, a positive score in CET and JEE mains. Now, over here, when I say three subjects, I mean that the three subjects are physics, maths, and the third subject could be biotechnology, or it could be biology, or it could be a vocational subject. So the aggregate in these three subjects should be minimum 45%. Now 45% is the criteria for open category, and for SC, ST, OBC, the criteria is 40%. Now, let me also tell you one more thing. Last year, this criteria was 50% and 45%. When this year, on 20th of October, a notification was issued where this clarification was given. So that's what I was telling you, that whatever rules I'll tell you, most of them will be of the previous year, but there's nothing which we can do over here. And anyway, that should not bother you so much because 90% of the rules will remain same. Now, the next thing is that how to secure a seat in an engineering college of Maharashtra. So if you want to take admission in an engineering college of Maharashtra, then there are two ways of securing a seat. One way is through CAP, which is online procedure, and another way is through institute level, which is almost an offline procedure. Now, let me tell you about CAP first. So this CAP over here stands for Centralized Admission Process. I repeat, CAP stands for Centralized Admission Process, and 95% of this process is online. Only once, or maybe at the most twice, you'll have to go to some particular place for verification, registration, but apart from that, it is online. We'll talk about this in great detail. Another way of securing a seat is through institute level. Now, what is this institute level? Now, till 5-6 years back, this institute level seat was called management quota, but now they have given it a better name called institute level seat, and this process is almost offline. Now, what happens is that in Maharashtra, the Maharashtra government has allowed every engineering college to fill 20% of their seats in the manner they want. That means, let's say in a college, if there are 200 seats, so 20% of 200 is 40. So the college is free to fill these 40 seats the way they want. I mean, they can decide their own merit criteria. They can give these seats depending on how much donation they get or whatever. Okay. Now, what happens is whether you want to, if you want to take admission through CAP, there are two admission phases, phase one and phase two, about which I'm going to talk in great detail. Now, phase one and phase two are both online. But if you want to go through institute level seat, okay, then what you need to do is you need to be a part of phase one, okay? But for phase two, you don't need to do anything online. You will not have phase two applicable to you. After phase one, what you'll have to do is you'll have to go to the college. You'll have to talk to college authorities. And there, you will have to do the procedure separately, okay? So basically, this if you want to take admission through institute level, okay, then that procedure is almost offline. Only phase one will be applicable to you. Phase two will not be applicable to you. Whereas if you want to take a seat through CAP, then both phase one and phase two will be applicable to you. Okay. Now, moving further, year onwards, many a times you will see a symbol like this. You will see a symbol like this. Now, year onwards, whenever you see a symbol like this, that means I'm going to tell you something very, 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 very important. You need to pay attention. So one important thing which I already told you is that even if you want to take admission through institute level, through management quota, still, you will have to be a part of phase one of the admission process. In other words, what every candidate needs to do is, I repeat the word every, okay? What every candidate needs to do is, every candidate needs to register himself or herself with the DTE so that he or she can take admission in an engineering college in Maharashtra, okay? And that registration work, that registration process is basically phase one of the admission process. So guys, even if you're planning to get into engineering through management quota, through institute level seat, please remember, you have to be a part of phase one. That is, you have to register with DTE. Unless and until you register with DTE, you cannot take a seat in Maharashtra Engineering College. Another important thing which I want to tell you over here is that you can become a part of CAP as well as institute level seat simultaneously. That means you can also do one thing. If you are, you can take a seat, let's say you take a seat in some particular college through institute level. So apart from taking a seat through institute level, you can also be a part of CAP. So many people have a misconception that this CAP and institute level are two mutually exclusive things. So that is not the case, okay? You can be a part of CAP and you can also reserve your seat through institute level in some college. Now, what exactly is CAP? I'll tell you very soon. I'll tell you in great detail. Another important thing which I want to tell you is, and take this very seriously, and that is, see, what happens is, as I told you, that every year, the DTE is going to issue the new set of rules. So what you need to do is, whenever this new brochure comes on the site, you need to take your time and you need to read these rules properly, okay? Now, I'll try to show you these rules over here. Let me see if I can. Just a minute, guys. So, I have this folder and inside this, you can see something like this. Admission notice 2019-20. So, what you will get this time will be admission notice 2020-21, something like that, okay? So, this is one document. Then there is one more document like, see, info brochure. So I'm expecting that these documents should come on the DTE website very soon. So once you get these documents on the DTE website, please take your time and read them very, very, very carefully because there could be minute changes in the rules with respect to the last year. Okay. So I hope I'm clear about that. Okay. Anyway, moving further. Now, once you understand all this, now let's quickly try and understand what all documents are required so that you keep these documents handy. So first of all, you'll require SSE mark sheet, you'll require HSE mark sheet, you'll require your JEE main scorecard if you want to take admission for All India seats. What is this All India seats? We'll talk about this also. Then you will require your school leaving certificate. you need a proof to prove that you are a Indian national. So for that, you need either a birth certificate or a college leaving certificate or a passport. Then you need to prove that you are a domicile of Maharashtra. By the way, a person is a domicile of Maharashtra if that person is born in Maharashtra or if that person has been living in Maharashtra since last 15 years continuously. Till 5-6 years back, what happened is that it was compulsory to have a domicile certificate to take admission in Maharashtra Engineering College. But luckily, fortunately, now this rule is no more there. So to prove that you are a domicile of Maharashtra, you need to have either your birth certificate mentioning your place of birth or your leaving certificate or some other document which mentions your place of birth. Okay. After that, we will talk a little about this TFWS. Okay. So listen to this carefully because not many of you know about this. Now, TFWS stands for Tuition Fee Waiver Scheme. I repeat, Tuition Fee Waiver Scheme. Now, what happens is that in every college, in every branch, now when I say branch, that branch could be computer engineering, information technology, electronics, anything. So in every college, in every branch, there are some seats which are reserved for TFWS candidates. Now, who are TFWS candidates? So these are the candidates whose annual income, these are those candidates whose parents' annual income is below 8 lakhs. So from all the sources combined, the annual income of your parents should be below 8 lakhs. And if this is the case, you are eligible for TFWS. Now, if you get a seat under TFWS, then your tuition fee will be waived. And that will bring you a huge relief because in that case, your college fees will become half or maybe even lesser than that. But to get the TFWS, you will need income certificate to prove that the income is below 8 lakhs. From where to get this income certificate, that also I'll tell you very soon. Then let's talk about minority candidates. Okay, now again, listen to me very carefully because many people have a misconception about this. So guys, what happens is year onwards, whenever we use this word minority, okay, minority will not mean, I repeat, minority will not mean SC, ST, OBC or backward classes and so on. Okay, no, that does not mean minority. So in this particular webinar, when I say minority, it is either religious minority or linguistic minority. Now, what exactly it means? So what happens is, in many colleges of Mumbai, there are seats, there are 51% of the seats, I repeat, in many Mumbai colleges, 51% of the seats are reserved for students belonging to a particular religion or for students speaking a particular language. Now, let me give you an example of a very famous college called DJ Sanghvi, which is in Vile Parle West. So DJ Sanghvi is Gujarati minority college. So Gujarati minority means it is linguistic minority Gujarati. So in DJ Sanghvi, 51%, you heard it right, 51% of the seats are reserved for Gujarati speaking people. And the remaining seats are for remaining people. In fact, even Gujaratis can claim a seat in the remaining quota, but 51% is only for Gujarati speaking people. That way, there are two colleges like Thadomal, in short, we call it TSEC, which is in Bandra, and Swami Vivekanand, both very good colleges. Swami Vivekanand is in Chembur. These two colleges are Sindhi minority colleges. So a Sindhi person can play, basically in these two colleges, 51% of the seats are reserved for Sindhi speaking people. Then there are religious minority colleges like St. Francis is Christian minority, Sabu Siddiq in Mumbai Central is Muslim minority, and so on. Okay. So whenever I say minority, I mean religious or linguistic minority. Now, if you want to claim a seat as a minority candidate, then the first of all, you will have to fill up something called pro forma O. Now, what exactly this pro forma O is? So let me take you to page number, let's say 65. All right. Now, The brochure which you are going to get from DTE, in that brochure, there are many forms which you need to fill up. Okay. So over here, see, this is the brochure of the last year, and you see something called pro forma O, and it says minority community student self-declaration. So this is the self-declaration which you need to submit in the college where you intend to take the admission. Apart from that, what happens is, in your leaving certificate, many a times your mother tongue is mentioned. So if you have your leaving certificate in which your mother tongue is mentioned, you should also submit this document to the college. In case you don't have that leaving certificate, then you need to prepare an affidavit which will state about your mother tongue or your religion. And in some colleges, they say that bring a certificate, bring a letter from your samaj. So what you need to do is, if you intend taking admission in some minority college, you should actually go there and you should ask the people over there that what kind of documents are required. Okay. After that, you will need a caste certificate. You will need a caste or tribe validity certificate. You will need non-creamy layers certificate valid till 31st March 2021. Look at this date very carefully. But first of all, let me tell you that the last three certificates are only for this particular category. That means VJ, NT, SC, SBC, OBC, and so on. Okay, so the last three documents are not required for everybody. And once again, if you are from OBC, then you will need a non-creamy layer certificate which is valid till 31st March 2021. Now, in my past years, many a times I have seen that students have this certificate, but many a times that certificate has already expired. Okay, so if you already have this certificate, check this date over here. Okay, if this date is not 31st March 2021, you will land up in trouble. Now, if you want to make these documents, then you can make these documents pretty easily on this particular website. All right, so if you want, I'll pause the video. And you can take a photo of this particular screen, or you can take a screenshot. All right, resuming further. One more thing on this particular, as far as I think, I'm not very sure about it. On this particular website, you'll be able to make all your documents except this validity certificate. Okay, so you just need to go to this website and check this. All right. Now, once you understand the documents required, the next thing is that almost a year back, the government of India had introduced something called economically weaker section. All right. So this economically weaker section is similar, or I will say almost same as TFWS. So this time when the new set of rules are released, okay, it is quite possible that TFWS is being replaced by EWS. But even if it is replaced by EWS, still the rules will remain same, because for EWS also the limit is 8 lakhs. All right. Okay. Now, moving further to different universities and college types. Okay. Now things are going to get interesting. Okay. You should be more attentive now. Now what happens is, these are all the universities in the state of Maharashtra. So for example, you have Pune University, all right, you have Pune University, then you have Mumbai University, you have SNDT University, and so on. Now we are concerned only about Mumbai University over here, because we all live in Mumbai. Now, apart from these universities, there is something called ICT, which stands for Institute of Chemical Technology, and it is situated in Matunga, Mumbai. Now, ICT was earlier called UDCT, okay, University Department of Chemical Technology. And ICT is considered to be the best institute if somebody wants to do chemical engineering. Okay. This ICT is called deemed university. Now, what is the meaning of deemed? So deemed means that this university is granted a special status by UGC of India. Okay. And deemed university status is given to those universities which do some kind of research. So ICT is basically deemed university. After that in Mumbai, we also have SNDT University. All right. So SNDT is only for girls. All right. I hope you know it is situated in Juhu. Now, many a times you'll come across this term home university. Okay, in short, it is called HU. And one more term, OHU, that is out of home university. Now, what is the meaning of these two terms? So, if you live in Mumbai, listen to me carefully. If you live in Mumbai, then for you guys, Mumbai University is the home university. And if somebody lives in Pune, then for that person, Mumbai University is out of home university. So for a Pune guy, Mumbai University is out of home. Whereas from a Mumbai guy, it is home university. And the vice versa will happen over here. So basically, home university is that university where you reside. Okay, so for you guys, home university is Mumbai University. Now, till last year in Mumbai, there were 68 colleges with a sanctioned intake of 28,300. So there were 28,300 seats, and many of these seats were vacant. So guys, that's what I told you in the very beginning, that if you want to get into engineering, you will get into engineering. That is not a big deal. You just have to maximize, optimize your chances of getting into a better college. Now, let's understand a few terms over here. So we have government aided versus unaided. Then we have autonomous versus non-autonomous. We have minority versus non-minority. Okay. Now, a government aided college is that college which will receive funds, from the government. Okay. So a government college or government aided college will receive financial assistance from government, whereas unaided college or private college will receive no funds, no financial assistance from the government. So basically, these two terms, government aided and unaided, they are opposite of each other. Now, what is autonomous and non-autonomous? So autonomous college is that college which can decide its own syllabus and which can conduct its own exams. Whereas the non-autonomous college will follow the syllabus of the Mumbai University or any affiliated university. And moreover, it also has to follow the exams of that particular university. Then what is minority and non-minority? So I hope you remember that what is the meaning of minority and non-minority. So minority college is that college where 51% of the seats are reserved for linguistic or religious minority. And non-minority is that college where there is no reservation on the basis of language and religion. I repeat, there is no reservation on the basis of language and religion. But in non-minority colleges, there will be a reservation of SC, ST, OBC and that. Okay, so that is a different thing. So now, if you are paying attention, you will realize this thing, government aided versus private. This has something to do with the funds received or not received. Autonomous versus non-autonomous has something to do with the syllabus and the exams. Minority versus non-minority has something to do with the reservation. Okay. Now moving ahead, there is something called university managed colleges. Now what is university managed colleges? So it means there is a single university. It means that there is a university, and in this university, there is a single college. Under this university, there is one college. So for example, in Juhu, SNDT can be called as a university as well as a college. And the same thing is applicable to BATU, that is Baba Saheb Ambedkar Technological University, which is in Lonere. So university managed college means there is a university under which there is one college. Now, you already know that ICT is deemed university, so we spoke about it. Now let's talk about this government or government aided autonomous colleges. By now, I hope that when you say government or government aided, it has something to do with the funds, and autonomous has something to do with syllabus and exams. So in Maharashtra, there are four colleges which are government aided and also autonomous. So we have VJTI in Matunga, the number one college in Mumbai, the number one college in Maharashtra probably. Then SPCE, Sardar Patel College of Engineering in Andheri West. Then we have College of Engineering Pune and College of Engineering Karad. Okay, these four. Now guys, what happens is that in Maharashtra, 99% of the colleges, I repeat, 99% of the colleges are private colleges, unaided colleges. So we'll talk about them in great detail. Okay. Now, if you talk about private colleges, I will say that they come in these four categories. Okay. Autonomous non-minority, example is SPIT. Autonomous minority, examples are DJ Sanghvi and KJ Samoya Vidya Vihar. Then we have non-autonomous non-minority and we have non-autonomous minority. Now, you already know the meaning of these terms, autonomous, minority and so on. So I hope you will automatically understand that what are these four categories. So you have something called SPIT, Sardar Patel Institute of Technology in Andheri West, which is autonomous but non-minority. Now let me just talk a little about this SPIT and SPCE. This SPIT and SPCE are in the same campus, but the difference is that SPCE has three branches, civil, mechanical, electrical. SPIT has three branches, that is computers, IT, electronics. SPCE is funded by the government and that is why it is government aided, whereas SPIT is private. Okay, but although it is private, it is autonomous. Then you have autonomous minority, all right, which are DJ Sanghvi in Villeparle, KJ Somaya Vidya Vihar, which is in Vidya Vihar near Ghatkopar. Now, one thing which I want to tell you over here, even if you take admission in an autonomous college, the degree which you are going to get will be that of MU. That is not the case with a deemed university. If you get into ICT, which is a deemed university, the degree which you will get will be of ICT itself, not of MU. Now, I think I can even show this to you. So I had a student, in fact, I have many students in KJ Somaya Vidya Vihar. So see, this is the degree of one of my students. So this is the degree of one of my students. Okay. So if you see carefully over here, I hope you can see this. I'll just zoom it a little. So if you see this over here, it says KJ Somaya College of Engineering Autonomous. See this. Okay. But over here, if you see, it says University of Mumbai. All right. So even if you are doing engineering from some autonomous college, the degree which you are going to get will be of MU. After that, we have non-autonomous, non-minority. So the examples are RAIT and TERNA, which are in Nerul. Then you have non-autonomous minority. Such colleges are TSEC, Thadomal, Vesit. Vesit means Vivekanand, which is in Chembur, and many others. I think Thakur has become autonomous now, so I can cancel Thakur from here. Okay. Anyway. So guys, now what is the most important thing which you need to understand over here? Please listen to me carefully. As I told you that I'm going to give you some very simple tricks and techniques. So the first thing which you need to understand is that as far as possible, you should try to take admission in a minority college, because getting into a good minority college will be very easy for you if you have decent score. So let's say you are a Gujarati speaking person. So if you are a Gujarati speaking person, you have two very good, in fact, I'll say awesome colleges. And that is DJ Sanghvi, that is DJ Sanghvi over here, and KJ Somaya Vidya Vihar. If you are a Sindhi, again, two very good colleges, TSEC and Vesit over here. All right. So keep in mind that if you belong to some particular linguistic or religious minority, try to get into those colleges, because getting in those colleges will be easier for you. Okay, so that is the first tip, the first suggestion of this web. This is the first suggestion of this webinar, which will help you to get into a better college. The point I'm trying to make over here is, let's say you and your friend both have the same score, both have the same merit number. Let's say you are Gujarati, your friend is not a Gujarati. So for you, it will be easier to get into DJ Sanghvi and KJ Somaya, but not for your friend. And mind you that DJ Sanghvi, KJ Somaya, TSEC, Vesit are amongst the top 5-6 colleges of Mumbai. So guys, if you are a Gujarati, okay, let me bring it to very simple terms. If you are a Gujarati or if you are a Sindhi, okay, you are very lucky. There are some good colleges which you should aim for. Okay. Unfortunately, there is no reservation for Maharashtrians for a very simple reason that we live in Maharashtra. So in Maharashtra, Marathi cannot be a minority. Okay. Anyway, moving further. Now, let's talk about the seat distribution. So over here, I'll show you some tables. So when the DTE releases the document for this particular year, you will see the table like this in the DTE brochure. But this table, many people don't understand this table properly. So I'll just try to explain you this table with the help of certain examples. Now, let's take this example. Okay. Government or government aided institutions. So let's take example of, VJTI. Okay. Now, VJTI is a government institution. Now, let's say in VJTI for civil engineering, there are 60 seats. Okay. Now, the first thing which you should notice is over here under all India seats, it is written nil. So that means VJTI will not give you admission on the basis of JEE mains. VJTI will give you admission only on the basis of Maharashtra CET. There are no all India seats in VJTI. Okay. Then over here, again, there are two categories, autonomous and non-autonomous. So VJTI is autonomous. So here it is written 100% state level. So this is the simplest thing. So here what will happen is all the 60 seats, 60 out of 60 seats will be state level seats, which means these 60 seats are equally available, to a student, whether that student is in Pune, whether that student is of Pune or Mumbai or Solapur or whatever. No discrimination will be made between a Mumbai student and a Pune student over here. Now, over here, let's jump to Institute of Chemical Technology. So let's say in Institute of Chemical Technology, let's say there are a total of 100 seats for chemical engineering, obviously, because it is ICT. So here, as you see, all India seats is 30%, which means out of 100, 30 seats will be given on the basis of JEE main, and the remaining 70 seats will be given on the basis of Maharashtra CET. All right. Now, if you don't understand, no problem. I'll take a more difficult example after which things will become more clear. Now, have a look at this table. This table is for private colleges, unaided colleges. So you have unaided minority colleges over here. So which are unaided minority colleges like TSEC, DJ Sanghvi, and so on. Now, let's take example of DJ Sanghvi College, where DJ Sanghvi College is unaided, it is minority, and it is autonomous. Okay. So now pay good attention. Things are going to be interesting. Now, let's say in DJ Sanghvi for computer engineering, there are 60 seats. Actually, there are more, but let's assume there are 60 seats for computer engineering in DJ Sanghvi. Now, what will happen is, as you see over here, minority quota 51%. So out of 60, 51% seats are straight away reserved for Gujaratis. Okay. So if you are a Gujju, okay, please, okay, I'm taking the liberty of calling you a Gujju. So if you are a Gujju, straight away 31 seats are reserved for you. Okay. I'm sure many of you are smiling right now. Anyway, now after that, 20% of the seats are reserved for institute. Okay. This is the institute level seat, also called the management quota. So 20% of 60, that is 12. So now the institute will have 12 seats, which it can fill in any way. I repeat, any way it wants. The Maharashtra government, DTE, will not interfere over here. Now 31 plus 12 is 43, and 60 minus 43 is 17. So now only 17 seats remain. Okay, now see the calculation. Now over here, see, it is given all India seats, 15% of seats under cap, and there is a hash over here. So many people will not understand this properly. When we say 15%, it is 15% of these remaining 17 seats. Okay. So 15% of 17 is approximately equal to 3. That means over here, all India seats will be equal to 3, only 3. Okay. So on the basis of JEE main, only 3 seats are there. Now, after that, if it is DJ Sanghvi, then it is autonomous. So it says 100% of the seats are Maharashtra state seats. Now, don't be too happy when you see 100% over here. Now, 17 minus 13 is 14. So if it is a DJ, if it is DJ Sanghvi College, now all the 14 seats, all the 14 seats are for Maharashtra state candidates. And these Maharashtra state candidates could be anyone, could be anyone. All right. Now, let's say the college which we are talking about is TSEC, Thadomal College in Bandra. So Thadomal College in Bandra is unaided, minority, but non-autonomous. So if it is non-autonomous, the calculation will be same till this 14. Okay. After that, what will happen? As you see over here, 70% of the seats are for HU and 30 is for OHU. So what is 70 of 14? So 70 of 14, I think it is 10. Okay. So over there, 10 seats will be for students who reside in Mumbai, and the remaining 4 seats will be for outsiders. Okay. So I hope you understood this calculation. Now also have a look over here. Come on. Now I would want you to do this calculation with me. Now let's take example of unaided private college, autonomous college. Let's take example of SPIT. So SPIT is private and it is autonomous, but it is not minority. Now once again, let's assume that there are 60 seats in computer engineering in SPIT. There are more, I think, but let's assume there are 60. So once again, 20%, that means 12 seats are given to the institute. Minority quota is nil. Now, there is a good news for those students who have given JEE Main. Now, out of this, Now, over here, when we say 15%, this 15% is of the total 60. So over here, what is 15% of 60? 15% of 60 is 9. So what will happen is, out of 60, 12 seats, okay, 12 seats is given to college, so institute seats, all right. Nine seats are all India seats, okay. So now 12 plus 9 is 21, all right. After that, if it is autonomous, which is SPIT, then the remaining seat, 65% seat, will be state level seat. Now, I'm sure you understood all this. So in case of SPIT, 12 is for institute, 9 is for all India, and 12 plus 9 is 21. So the remaining is how much? 39. Yeah. So 39 seats will be for everybody in Maharashtra. Now, if you understood all these things, then what are the conclusions over here? So guys, pay good attention to what you are going to see in the next 2 minutes. I hope many of you must have realized one thing, okay, that there is no backward class reservation in minority colleges. Yes, you heard it right. And that is something which you guys should cheer about. Yes, that's the truth. So the thing is that in colleges like DJ Sanghvi, in colleges like Thadomal, Vivekanand, and so on, There is no reservation for SC, ST, OBC, and so on. So why do I say that this is a good news for you? See, if you belong to that particular community, so for example, if you are a Gujarati, then now you have such bright chances of getting into KJ Somaiya or DJ Sanghvi. If you are a Hindi-speaking person, North Indian, then you have a good chance of getting into Thakur College, which is in Kandili East. So, as I told you in the beginning of the webinar, I'm going to give you some simple tricks and techniques to optimize your chances of getting into a better college. So one simple trick and technique over here is that if you are a Gujarati, if you are a Sindhi, if you are a North Indian, if you are a Muslim, if you are a Christian, I think that covers many of you. So if you belong to these particular categories, then exploit all the chances which you have. Aim to get into a minority college, which is good and which is near your residence. Okay. So that is the first tip and technique of the day, the most important one. another trick, another tip which I need to give you is that students with good JEE main score should focus on non-minority college. Now, why did I say this? If you remember the earlier table which you saw, then you will realize that in non-minority colleges, out of 60, 9 seats, that is 15% of the seats, are reserved for JEE main students. So, if you believe that your JEE main score is good enough, then you aim for non-minority colleges. Okay. Many a times I have seen that a student does not have a very good JEE main score. Okay. But in spite of not having a good JEE main score, he or she will get into a very good college in Mumbai. Okay. Why? Because of the same reason. Because there are some very good colleges where more seats are allocated for JEE main. So I gave you one example of SPIT, the second best college in Mumbai. Now, moving further, let's talk about the admission process. Now, things will get more and more, I'll say, important. So guys, please listen to all this very carefully. Okay. Now, if we talk about admission process, the entire admission process is divided into two phases. Phase one, okay, which is called the online application form, and phase two, which is called option form. We'll talk about option form later on. Now, I have told you that is phase one is compulsory for everybody, no matter how you intend taking admission, whether through CAP or whether through institute level quota. Okay, so the phase one is called online application form. Now, what you need to do in phase one? So in phase one, what you need to do is, see, very soon DTE or your CET cell will announce the dates of admission. So once those dates are announced, what you need to do is you are given a login ID and password when you have registered for your CET. In case you have forgotten your password, you can generate that password using your date of birth, using your application number and the OTP which you'll get on your cell phone. So anyway, using your login ID and password, what you will do is you will log into that particular site. Now, there are some students who have not given CET. They have given only JEE, and they will obviously not have this login ID and password. So you too can generate this login ID password by paying fees of 800 rupees online. Anyway, now once you have generated the login ID and password, once you have these things to you, what you need to do is you need to log into the DTE website or the Maharashtra CET cell website. And you need to fill and submit the online application form. Now, what is this online application form? So in this online application form, you are basically supposed to give your credentials, like your name, your mobile number, your residence, your score, and many other things. Please keep one thing in mind. This is not the phase where you are supposed to give your choices that where you want to take your admission. No. In this online application form, you are just supposed to fill in your basic details. Okay. Not your options, not your choices that which college do you want. Now, so you'll fill this form. You'll also upload the required documents online. Then what you should do is whatever form you have filled online, you should take a printout of that particular form. You should sign that form and you should keep it with yourself. Take the printout, sign it, keep it with yourself. Now, once that is over, there's one very, very, very important thing which I want to tell you over here. Okay, whenever you get this symbol, that means I'm going to tell you something very important. Be attentive. The first thing is that while filling the online application form, you'll always see a checkbox. You will see a checkbox. And in front of this checkbox, it will be written, do you want to be considered for minority quota? Now, I have been taking these seminars since last many years, and many a times I have seen students doing a very, very, very big mistake over here. Now, what is that big mistake? Many students, okay, many Gujarati students, many Sindhi students, what they do is they don't put a tick mark over here. Because they believe that minority over here means SC, ST, OBC. So guys, if you don't put a tick mark over here, the DTE software will not consider you for that 51% seats which are reserved for you. Okay, so automatically your chances of getting into a good college are almost over. So without fail, put a tick mark over here if you belong to any minority. Another thing is, not always, but many a times in your option form, they will ask you, do you want to be considered for all India seats? Do you want to be considered for all India seats? Now, the first thing which you need to understand, I hope you have understood this, that all India seats are basically meant for those students who have given JEE Main. But listen to me carefully, whether you have given JEE Main or not, put a tick mark over here. Now, why? Because many a times the JEE Main seats will remain empty. And if they remain empty, then in the last round, they will come in the common pool. And when it comes to the common pool, then even you can claim this seat even if you have not given JEE Main. Okay, so put a tick mark here also. Now, moving further, once you have done all these things, then what you need to do is you need to go to Setu Suvidha Kendra. You need to go to Setu Suvidha Kendra. Now, what is this Setu Suvidha Kendra, this thing? So basically what will happen is every engineering college, I repeat, every engineering college will be made a Setu Suvidha Kendra. So this Setu Suvidha Kendra is basically a place where you need to go and you need to submit some documents about which I'll tell you very soon. Now, once again, let me just try to show you something. So what happens is in another few days, DTE will release a document in which all the Setu Suvidha Kendra details will be given. So for example, we guys are in Mumbai. So I hope you can see this. So look, this is the Mumbai city. And over here, for example, see, you can see Borivali. I hope you can see this. Let me just try to zoom it. Okay, so over here you see Mumbai suburban Borivali, and in front you are you will see Thakur College of Engineering, which is in Kandivali East. So this is the address of Thakur College of Engineering. All right, then this is the person whom you are supposed to meet and also his phone number. So basically, what will happen is after a few days, all these details will be there on the DTE site, and you will get a list of all the Setu Suvidha Kendra, which are basically nothing but the engineering colleges of Mumbai. Okay, so what you are supposed to do is you will go to this Setu Suvidha Kendra in person. That means you will go yourself along with your parents if you want to, and you will take that printout of the application form which you had filled over here. So I hope you remember that you have filled one form over here. You will take its printout. Okay. Along with this printout, you will take your original documents. You will take your original documents. Okay. And you will take two sets of attested photocopies. Now, what will happen over here is you will submit your application form over here. Then after submitting, they will do the verification. Okay. And whatever photocopies you have, those photocopies will be stamped. And eventually you will be given a receipt. You'll be given a receipt. Now, one practical advice I'll give you. Many a times what will happen is that you will go to this Setu Suvidha Kendra. Okay. And the person sitting over there may tell you that come tomorrow and take the receipt. Today our printer is not working. This is not working. That is not working. If somebody tells you this, then please tell that person that I'm willing to wait for another 5 hours, but I want the receipt today itself. Because what happens is many a times you'll go the next day over there and you will find some other person over there and that is going to cause you huge inconvenience. So don't do that. Okay, take the receipt on the very same day. So basically you'll go to the Setu Suvidha Kendra. You will submit your application form whose printout you have taken. You will take your original documents. You will take your photocopies. The people sitting over there will do the verification. They will stamp your photocopies and they'll give you a receipt. Now, once that is over, listen to me carefully. Once that is over, phase one is over. Or I will say phase one is almost over. Now, why phase one is almost over? Why did I use the word almost? So listen to me carefully. Now, what happens is after all this is done, maybe a week after this, the DTE will release the merit number on its website, which it has allotted you. So what happens is, depending on your CET score, depending on your CET percentile, the DTE, Directorate of Technical Education in Maharashtra, will award you a merit number. If you believe that your merit number is correct, okay, there is no discrepancy, then you don't need to do anything. But let's say there is a discrepancy in your merit number. Now, discrepancy means what? So it means, let's say your friend has score lesser than you, but his merit number is above you. His score is lesser, but his merit number is above you. So if something like this happens, you will go to the Setu Suvidha Kendra again. You will bring this thing to their notice. They will do the rectification. And a week after that, a new list will be released on their website, and that will be considered as the final list. Okay. Now, I also want to show you a few things over here. So, see, over here, as you see, there's a document called admission notice. So you will get this document on DTE side maybe after a week or something. All right. So I hope you can see there are some dates given over here. All right. So for example, over here, you see 17th June 2019. By the way, every year the admission process is carried out in the month of June, July, August. This year it got delayed for obvious reasons. So basically, guys, these are the dates which will be given to you, and you need to follow these dates. Later on, if you want, you can take a screenshot of this and you can just read them to get an idea of the different the different dates and what are you are supposed to do on these dates. So if you want, you can take a screenshot of this and then I'll scroll this up. All right, I'll scroll this a little up so that you can take one more screenshot if you wish to. All right, guys, moving further. So basically, by now the phase one of the admission process is over. Now, once phase one is over, you will have your merit number with you. Now, let's start with phase two of the admission process. And the phase two is called CAP round. CAP stands for centralized admission process. And generally, there are three CAP rounds. Now, whatever I'm going to tell you over here, please be very attentive. Okay, stop doing everything and pay good attention to this, because who knows, this may bring a big difference in whatever college you're going to get. Okay, later on, I'll also tell you a story about a student who did not pay attention over here and then what happened with him. Anyway, let's move further. So once the phase two, that means once the CAP round start, what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to go to the DTE site again. And you are supposed to fill a form called options form. I repeat, you are supposed to fill a form called options form. And in this options form, there will be 300 options. So you are supposed to give minimum one and maximum 300 options. Now you will ask me, what is the meaning of the word option? So I'll tell you in great detail, but for time being, just understand, a college branch combination is an option. I repeat, a college branch combination is an option. So you can say Thadomal College Computer Engineering is one option. Thadomal College Information Technology is second option. Thadomal College Computer Engineering TFWS is the third option that way. So every branch college combination is called an option. But let's understand what is this option in great detail. So when you fill this form, okay, as I told you, you are supposed to fill minimum one and maximum 300 options. Now on the options form, every option is basically a 9-digit code. And this 9-digit code will indicate the university or the college which you want. It will indicate the course which you want. It will indicate the shift which you want. I'll tell you the meaning of shift very soon. And it will also indicate whether you want to claim the seat under TFWS or general. Okay. So basically the college could be, let's say Thakur College, course could be computer engineering. Okay. And TFWS, you already know. What is shift? I'll tell you. Now to understand this, I have an example over here. So once again, the DT brochure which you are going to get, in that brochure, you will see details of all the colleges which are in Maharashtra. And one college, the details of one college will be on one page. So that way, this is the detail. This is the detail of Vivekananda College. In short, it is called VESID. And it is a Sindhi minority college situated in Chembur. Tremendously famous. One of the top 5-6 colleges in Mumbai. Now, over here, if you see that if you want to take computer engineering in VESID, then the intake is 120. Okay, 120 seats are there. And you see this choice code. So the choice code over here is 318524510. Okay. So on the previous screen, I was telling you option, option, option. So that option is basically this thing. This number which you see over here, this number is the option which I was talking about. So if you want to take, if you want to take computer engineering in Vivekananda College, then basically this is the number which will enter in the options form. Now in this number, what will happen is the first four digits, 3185, it stands for the university and the college. So 3185 is the code for Vivekananda. So as you see over here, all the branches, see carefully, all the branches start with 3185, see. After that, 245 is the code for computer engineering. All right. This zero stands for non-TFWS. Zero stands for non-TFWS. And this one is the shift. Okay, now let's talk a little about this one, which is the shift. So what happens, guys, that because of huge demand for courses like computer engineering, what AICTE has done, the full form of AICTE is All India Council for Technical Education. So what AICTE has done is it has allowed some colleges to run some courses in two shifts. So there will be a morning shift and there will be an afternoon shift. The morning shift will be from, let's say, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. And the afternoon shift will be something like, let's say, 12 p.m. to 7 p.m., something like that. Okay. So this morning shift is called first shift and the afternoon shift is called the second shift. So if you want to take computer engineering in Vivekananda in second shift, then what you will do is, instead of putting one over here, you will put two over here. By the way, the cutoff for the second shift is often lesser than that of the first shift. Okay. And if you want to take computer engineering in Vivekananda under the TFWS scheme, then what you will do is you will put a one over here, one, one, and you will also put a T, where T stands for TFWS. So guys, your option form will basically have numbers like these, where one number, one 9-digit number is one choice, one option. And that way you can fill maximum 300 options. Okay. Now, after you submit your option form, it is going to look like this. So I will just wait here for a while and you can probably have a look at this. So basically this student has given option number one, something like 60066 and then 61210. Then option number two, three, and he has given maximum 10 options. Okay. You can see over here that you can give 300 choice codes. Choice code is nothing but an option. Now moving further. Now, again, please be attentive. Now you will submit the option form and after that, basically you will wait for the results of round one. Okay. So by now what you have done is you have submitted the option form where you were supposed to fill minimum one and maximum 300 choices, 300 options. Now, what will happen over here is when the results are announced, one possibility is that seat is not allotted to you. So if seat is not allotted to you, no problem. You're automatically eligible for next round. Now, another option is that seat is allotted to you. But here also, there are two things which may take place. So please be attentive. One is that it is quite possible that you are allotted your first preference. Okay, let's say you had given DJ Sanghvi College Computer Engineering as your first preference, and let's say luckily that first preference is allotted to you. If that first preference is allotted to you, listen to me carefully, if that first preference is allotted to you, then that first preference is auto frozen. Okay, DTE software will auto freeze that first preference. Now, auto freeze means what? Auto freeze means that now you are not eligible for any subsequent cap rounds. You are out of the cap rounds, and you must take this first option. So basically, DTE will tell you that take it or leave it forever. If you don't take this seat, you are out of cap rounds forever. Although you can still take a seat under the institute level quota. That is a totally different process. Okay, that is an offline process. I am talking about cap. So if you don't take your first preference, you are out of cap, and the first preference is often auto froze. Sorry. Now, there are a few important things which I'll tell you over here, but let me move further. Now, let's say you are allotted a seat, but you are not allotted your first preference. You are allotted any other preference apart from the first preference. Now, before I move further, I would like to show you a photograph over here. So, look at this. So this is a screenshot of the computer, of that screen where you are supposed to freeze your option. So for example, this student over here, the seat which is allotted to this student is this one, 4221-4410. I hope you can see this. Even if you can't see this properly, it's okay. I'll try to zoom it a little. Okay. So this is the seat which is allotted, 4221-4410. Okay, this could be any college, any branch. All right, when I say branch, I mean the course. Now see carefully, there are two options over here, freeze and not freeze. If you see the two options over here, it means this is definitely not his first preference. Now over here, either you can click on freeze or you can click on not freeze. Okay, now what happens is, whether you click on freeze or not freeze, after that you will click on get OTP. You will enter the OTP over here and you will click on this update seat acceptance status. Now, what is this freeze and not freeze? So let's talk about it. So let's say you are given any choice, but that is not your first choice. So now what will happen is you will have two options, freeze or don't freeze. Okay. Now, let's say you freeze that option. Listen to me very carefully, please. Let's say you freeze that option. If you freeze that option, then what you should do is, then what happens is, if you choose freeze, then that means now you must compulsorily take that seat, okay? Else you are out of cap rounds. So basically, guys, if you are allotted your first preference, or if you have chosen freeze yourself, then you must compulsorily take that seat. Now what you should do is, now you should go to ARC. So ARC stands for Admission Reporting Center. Again, some engineering colleges will be designated as ARC. So you should go to ARC. You should give them all the required documents. You should give them seat acceptance fees of 1,000 rupees. And then you should report to the college where you have taken admission. So this will complete your procedure. All right. Now, my advice over here is that if you're not very sure that you want this college, this seat, then what you should do is you should not choose freeze over here. Okay. Now, let's say you have clicked on don't freeze. Okay. You have clicked on don't freeze. Now, please listen to me carefully. If you're not attentive, then what will happen is I will tell you something and you may think otherwise. Okay, so listen carefully. If you click on don't freeze, okay, even after clicking on don't freeze, listen to me carefully, please. Even after clicking on don't freeze, you should go to ARC. You should pay them 1000 rupees seat acceptance fee. Okay, you should go to ARC, you should pay them 1000 rupees seat acceptance fee. That means you have accepted the seat. Now, some of you may have a question in mind that in this case, what is the difference between freeze and don't freeze? So the difference is, listen carefully, the difference is, although you are accepting the seat over here, you are still eligible. You are still eligible for round two and round three. That means you can fill the option form again and you can aim for a better college or a better course. And don't forget one thing, that you have accepted this seat over here. So what will happen is the seat which you have accepted over here, it will be retained for you even in round two. Okay, very soon I'll talk about this also. But remember one thing, that even if you're clicking on don't freeze, you should still go to ARC. You should pay 1000 rupees. You should accept the fees. Although you should accept the seat. Although you are now eligible for rounds two and three. Okay. So guys, now what are the important things which you should understand over here? The most important thing is that when you are giving your first preference, okay, never ever give a preference which you think you will easily get. Never ever give a preference which you think you will easily get. I'll talk a little more about this on the next slide. Another thing which you should pay attention to is that if you're not very sure of the college and the course, then don't freeze it. Okay. In fact, I always tell my students that even if you're sure that, okay, I'm satisfied with this college and this course, still you click on don't freeze. Why? Because even if you do that, that seat will be retained for you in the next round. You will not lose that seat. Okay. Now moving further. Now second and the third round will be exactly same as round one. So there is nothing new to be told to you over here. The only difference is that in third round, everything will be final. So whatever is allotted to you, whether it is your first option or 10th option, you have to take it. Okay. Another thing is that in second and third round, the option form can be edited. That means, let's say you have filled the option form in round one. So now in round two, what you can do is you can completely change the option form, or you can fill in new choices, or you can change the order. You can do whatever you want to do. And as I have been telling you earlier, that the seat which you got in round one will be automatically retained for you. Don't put that seat once again in your option form. What happens is, understand this properly. Let's say in round one, you were allotted Thakur College Computer Engineering. I repeat, Thakur College Computer Engineering. So what will happen is that in round two, let's say you are putting these five options, option one, option two, option three, option four, option five. And your aim is to now get in these colleges, okay, which is maybe better than Thakur. Now what the DTE software will do, I repeat, what the DTE software will do, at position number six, it will automatically put Thakur College Computer Engineering. Thakur College Computer Engineering. So now what will happen is that if you don't get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you will automatically get Thakur College Computer Engineering. Okay, so that seat is retained for you. Actually, the software used by DTE is a very good software. In fact, it is awesome. It works very nicely. All right, there are no glitches in it. It works superbly. So don't put that option once again. Now, after the final allotment is done, you will go to the institute and you will pay the difference fees. Difference fees means that, I hope you remember that you are supposed to go to ARC and pay 1000 rupees. So if your college fees is 1 lakh, then you will pay 99,000 to your college. Okay. Now, once that is understood, let's talk a little about institute level seats. I hope you realize one thing, that whatever I was talking here, it was about those seats which are through CAP, which are through DTE. Okay. Now we are talking about institute level seat. If you want to claim an institute level seat, then you don't need to be a part of the CAP rounds. You don't need to fill the option form. what you need to do is you need to go to the institute. Okay, you need to go to the institute and you need to do their procedure separately. Now keep one important thing in mind, that institute level seat is not same as minority seat. Okay, there is a difference between the two. When I say minority, I mean linguistic or religious minority, and this comes under CAP. This comes under CAP. Institute level seat is something totally different. It is basically management quota. Some colleges may ask you for a donation. Now listen to this carefully. In fact, I am pretty sure it must have happened with some of you. Now what will happen is, very soon you will start getting phone calls or you will start getting SMS, and in those phone calls they will tell you that I am from so and so college, and this year the results are very bad and you will probably not get into a good college. So our college is offering you so and so seat, but you have to pay so and so donation. Please don't fall for this trap. Okay, this is a trap. Don't fall for it. Okay, these colleges who sell their seats in 10 lakhs, 15 lakhs rupees, trust me guys, after 2 months seats in these colleges remain vacant, and that time they may again call you and they will tell you to come and take that seat for free of cost. When I say free of cost, I mean you have to pay the normal legal annual fees, but no donation. Okay, so please do not pay donation to get into any college. But I will also like to tell you over here, if you get a chance to get into some very good college like KJ Somaiya or DJ Sanghvi without donation, I repeat, without donation, then you can go for those colleges. Okay, pay the legal fees, that is okay. But don't fall into the trap of giving donations. There are some colleges which have a bad name in this aspect. Unfortunately, I cannot name them right now. I may tell you those colleges on a personal level. Now, so this was our advice on institute level seats. Never ever pay the donation. Now, moving further. Now, the next thing which we'll talk about, I'll give you some tips for filling the option form where you're supposed to fill minimum 1 and maximum 300 choices. Now guys, this part is very, very, very important. Please be attentive. I am going to give you a very simple trick to optimize your chances of getting into a good college. Okay. So first of all, you know that you are supposed to give minimum 1 and maximum 300 choices, 300 options. The first thing is that don't directly fill the form online. See, whenever you are online, you are into some kind of pressure. Okay. So this is pretty normal. Okay. This is pretty normal. Whenever you are online, you will have some kind of pressure on you. And because of that pressure, you may make some mistakes. So what you should do is, see, you will be getting at least 7 days. I repeat, you'll be getting at least 7 days for filling this option form. So what you can do is, in those 7 days, you can prepare a list of those options on a piece of paper or on an Excel sheet. Okay. So always remember this thing, that never ever directly fill the option form online. First prepare a list on a sheet of paper or maybe on an Excel sheet. Sorry. Now, once you do that, what next? Now, very, 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 very important. What I'm going to tell you now is horribly important. Listen to me very carefully. Now, when you're filling this option form, okay, when you're preparing this list, use the 3D rule. Now, what is this 3D rule? Okay, so it's very important. Be attentive. The 3D rule is this: dream, difficult, definite. Okay, dream, difficult, definite. Now, what exactly it means? I'll explain you what it means. But before I explain you what it means, I'll also tell you one thing. See, many a times students call us and they ask us that, sir, I have so-and-so score. My merit number is so-and-so. So will I get into this college? Will I get into that college? So there are two things which I want to tell you. The first thing is that it is very difficult to predict that you are going to get into which college. Okay. There are some coaching classes which will give you false advice. Yeah, you will get in this college, that college. Okay, but these things are not certain because there are many, many, many criteria which will affect these things. Okay, So the first thing is, nobody can tell you for sure that where you are going to get with your score. The second thing which I'm going to tell you is that if you follow the 3D rule, if you follow the 3D rule, you don't need to bother about the cutoffs. You don't need to bother that you have so and so marks and where you are going to get. Okay. So now you must be wondering, what is this 3D rule? So let me explain that to you. Now, what happens is that whenever you're filling the option form, okay, you should fill the options in this sequence. Now, let's say with your school, let's say you want to go for computer engineering. I am a computer engineer, so I will always take computer engineering as an example. So let's say you want to go for computer engineering. Okay. Now, you know for sure that with your score, you are never going to get into VJTI computer engineering. Okay. Because VJTI computer engineering is probably for the toppers. But still, my advice is that in your option form, your choice number one should be VJTI computer engineering. Let's say you are sure that you are never going to get SPIT computer engineering. No problem. Okay. Still put SPIT computer engineering. You may ask me that why should I put these two options when I'm sure I'm not going to get. So I will ask you, why not? Why not? You have 300 options. Okay. And if you have these 300 options, I guarantee you, it will be very difficult for you even to put 20 options. Okay. So why not? Why not put these as first and second option? Okay. And trust the universe and trust God. Okay. Trust your fate. Who knows? Okay. Things may work out for you and you may get into these colleges. Okay. So the point I'm trying to make is that when you're filling up your options, the first set of options should be your dream colleges. Okay. That means this is something which you are pretty sure you are not going to get. This is something which you dream about. All right. After that, the next set should be something which is difficult, but you may still get it. It is still achievable. So for example, you may feel that it is difficult to get computer engineering in DJ Sanghi. It is difficult to get computer engineering in KJ Somaiya, in Thadomal, which is called TSEC. So if you believe that these colleges are pretty difficult to get, then this should be the next sequence. So after dream colleges, put those colleges which you think are difficult to get. And in the end, I repeat, in the end, you should put those colleges which you think you will get easily, which you think you will get definitely. For example, there is a college called Atharva in Malad West, okay, near this link road. All right. And Atharva cutoffs are always pretty less. So let's say you are sure that with your score, you will definitely get computer engineering in Atharva. So that should be your last option. Now, you may ask me, why should we do this? Why should we do this? Okay. So there are several reasons. Okay. Now, listen to this reason very carefully. Okay, what I'm going to tell you, listen to this very carefully. Now, this time, DTE does not have too much of days, too many days or too many months to carry out the admission procedure. Okay, because of coronavirus problem, okay, we are all running on a time crunch. Normally, this admission procedure starts in mid-June and it goes on till mid-August. But this time, we don't have that much time. So it is quite possible, listen to me very carefully, it is quite possible that over here it may happen that whatever seat you get, that seat may be auto frozen. I repeat, whatever seat you get, that seat may become auto freeze. All right. So in this case, now just wonder what will happen if you reverse this particular sequence. Now, I'm going to tell you a short real story of one such student. I have my classes in Mulund, Vashi, and I'm associated with Agarwal Education Center in Borivali. So I had a student in Mulund. He used to come to my Mulund classes from Dombivli. Okay. So he had attended one such seminar. Now this guy lives in Dombivli. Okay. And he had attended one such seminar, and I cannot take the name of the person who took that seminar, okay? But he is also an engineering coaching classes teacher, teaching in Borivali itself, okay? He teaches in Borivali and many other places. I cannot name him. So he asked this teacher that which should be the first option which I should put. So this teacher told him that do one thing, you put Atharva Computer Engineering as your first option, you will get it very easily. And this poor student, he listened to him and he gave Atharva Computer Engineering as his first option. To his disappointment, I repeat the word disappointment, to his disappointment, he got that seat. In the very first round, he got that seat. That seat was auto frozen and he was out of the subsequent cap rounds. In the subsequent cap rounds, that means in round two and round three, what he realized is that there were friends, he had friends whose scores were lesser than him. And these friends, they got into very good colleges like KJ Somaiya Vidya Vihar. They got into Vivekanand and colleges which are better than Atharva. Okay, although their scores were lesser than him. Not only that, after this webinar is over, I want you to do one thing. Please open Google Maps, not right now, after the webinar is over. And just type in Google Maps, Dombivli Station to Atharva College, Malad. And just see how much time it takes to travel from there to here. So if you travel from Dombivli to Atharva College, Malad, the one way time will be at least 2 hours. So guys, this poor guy, he had very good marks. He could have got into a good college of central suburbs like Vivekanand, like KJ Somaiya, but he had to travel all the way to Atharva College, which is not even a very good college. And the rest 4 years, he spent the remaining 4 years cursing this teacher, giving him all the bad words he could have given. Okay, so guys, don't do this mistake. And that is why this sequence of dream, difficult, definite is very important. If you follow this sequence, you don't need to bother about cutoffs. You don't need to bother about anything. Okay, just follow this sequence. Now, once you understand this, let me also tell you why you should not take these cutoffs very seriously. The first thing is that the cutoffs will keep on changing every year. But another thing is that it is very difficult. It is very difficult to decipher, to understand these cutoffs. For example, what you see in front of you is the cutoff table of Computer Engineering VJTI. So guys, just have a look in this table, okay? You will have cutoff of open category separately, SC separately, ST separately, VJ separately. In that also, for girls, there is a reservation. For that also, there will be separate cutoff. So it's very, very, very difficult to find out the cutoff for one particular college, for one particular branch, okay? My strong advice to you will be that don't fall into this cutoff trap, okay? Just find out the good colleges around you and fill the option form as per this 3D sequence, okay? Dream, difficult, definite. Moving ahead, now let's talk a little about admission cancellation or fees refund, sorry. So the first thing is that after taking admission into some college, if you want to cancel your admission, you can do that before the cutoff date. Earlier years, this cutoff date used to be 17th of August. Okay, but this time, obviously, it can't be 17th of August. Okay, it will be something else. So before 17th of August, you can cancel your admission in some college if you got admission in a better college. Now, if you want to cancel your admission, then what you need to do is you need to apply online for cancellation. Okay. So you will get one letter, online letter. You need to download that cancellation letter and you need to submit that cancellation letter to the institute. Okay. Now, what the institute will do is the institute will deduct fees of 1,000 rupees and will refund you the remaining amount. Now, remember one thing over here, that refund for institute level seats is also possible. So what will happen is some colleges may tell you that if it is an institute level seat, then the refund will not be given. Please remember one thing, no college, I repeat, no college can deny you refund before the cutoff date. If they deny you refund, you can sue them. Okay, you can report to DTE and they may even lose their license to run their college. Now, there is something interesting which I'll tell you over here. Listen to me carefully. A few minutes back, I told you that never ever give donation to any college for taking admission. Okay. Now, I'll tell you something with related over here. See, what happens is, as I told you, over here, 17th August is the cutoff date for engineering admissions. So what happens is, the colleges, listen to me carefully, the colleges are also in pressure to fill all their seats by this particular date. Now, let's say there is a particular college and let's say the total number of seats in this college is 200. Okay. And till this particular date, let's say only 180 seats are filled. That means 20 seats are still vacant. Now, the good thing over here, good thing for you, not for college. The good thing over here is, after 17th August, this college will not be able to fill these 20 seats forever. Now, although it appears to you as 20 seats, but actually these 20 seats become 80 seats. Now, can you tell me how these 20 seats will become 80 seats? Don't forget that there are 4 years of engineering. So when you multiply 20 into 4, it becomes 80. All right. Now, let's say the annual fees of each student, let's say the annual fees of each student is one lakh. Okay. So that means this college will lose 80 lakh rupees over a period of 4 years because it was not able to fill these 20 seats. I hope you understand this. Okay. So now what will happen is that even the college will have tremendous pressure to fill these seats. Okay. So what will happen is, listen to me very carefully. Those colleges who were very adamant, okay, who were boasting a lot about themselves and who did not give you a seat in the month of June or July, just before the cutoff date, it is quite possible that just before the cutoff date, they may give you a call and they will tell you that you come to the college on 16th August, just pay us the legal fees and so seat will be yours. So many a times I have seen that there is a student who does not have a very good score. Okay. All his friends got into some good college and this student is not yet admitted to some good college. But on the very last day, the lady luck smiles on him. Okay. And he gets admitted to some very good college because of this particular reason. Okay. So guys, that is what I've been telling you right from the beginning, that it is very easy to get into an engineering college. It is not at all difficult. Now, once that is over, one practical advice over here is that if you're about to cancel your admission, keep some extra amount handy with you. Now, why am I saying this, that keep some extra amount handy with you? The reason is very simple. The reason is that, what happens is, let's say you have taken admission in Thakur. Okay. And after some time, let's say you get admission in DJ Sanghvi, which is definitely a better college. Now you may want to cancel your admission in Thakur and go to DJ Sanghvi. Now, Thakur College will definitely cancel your admission, but he may tell you that I will give you the fees refund, let's say on 10th of August. Whereas DJ Sanghvi may tell you that you need to pay the fees by 9th of August. So in such situation, you may need some extra amount handy with you. So that is a practical advice from our side. Now, having understood all this, now let's talk about the selection of college. Okay, what factors you should consider while selecting a college? So while selecting the college, the most important factor is the placement record. Okay, try to find out that how many students are placed from this particular college and that too they are placed in which company. Okay, now many a times the colleges will tell you that our placement record is 100%. Now, when they say 100%, don't believe this percentage. it could be 100% of eligible students. Now, the eligible students could be only 2, 3, 4. Okay. So it means that they have placed only 2, 3, 4 students. All right. So ask them that what is the actual number of students which they have placed, and that too in which companies. The next important factor is traveling distance. Nothing to be explained over here. Another factor is tuition fees. Again, nothing to be explained. Then whether that college has a minority status or not. For example, if you are a Gujarati, look for colleges like, you know, DJ Sanghvi, KJ Somaiya, and so on. Then see branch-wise number of seats. For example, I had shown you the branch-wise number of seats for Vivekananda College. Now, Vivekananda College had 180 seats for computer engineering. Okay. So, let's say you want to take computer engineering. If you want to take computer engineering, then look for those colleges which have more seats of computer engineering. Okay. Then take feedback from existing students about the college. So when I say feedback, you can ask those students about the teaching staff, regularity of lectures. You can ask them about the infrastructure. That means how good the library lab is. You can ask them about the FE results. Now this FE result is a very, very big indicator about how good or how bad that college is. The FE results, by the way, FE stands for first year engineering. SE is second year, TE is third year, BE is final year. B stands for Bachelor of Engineering. So the FE result of most of the colleges the FE result of most of the colleges is never above 40%. That means in almost all colleges, 60% of the students will have a KT in some subject. KT means failing that subject. Okay. So if there is a college whose FE results are 50%, 60%, 70%, that means it is a very good college. All right. Now, as far as the teaching in college is concerned, remember one thing, that the teaching in all the engineering colleges is very, very, very bad. Now, right now, this may seem like an exaggeration to you. Okay, you may wonder that I'm going to pay 1 lakh each year and bad teaching. So, guys, that is the harsh reality. In fact, you will be surprised to know that the worst teaching is of a college like VJTI. The teaching staff of VJTI is one of the worst in entire Mumbai. All right, they hardly teach anything to their students. But this is the harsh reality. Many of you may not believe me right now, but give yourself 2 months and you'll come to know about this. Okay. So these are the factors which you should keep in mind while selecting a college. If you want, you can take a screenshot of this. Okay. Now, moving further. Now let's talk about selection of branch or stream or course. Now, these are some of the common branches of engineering. All right. And I think I have Vinayak sir with me on this particular webinar. So if he is with me, I will request him to talk a little about some of the branches over here. Vinayak sir, are you with me? Hello? Vinayak sir? Just give me a while, guys. Guys, give me a second. I'll just unmute Vinayak sir. Okay, just give me some time. Vinayak, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, just a minute. I'll just put the slide. Just a minute.
Yeah.
Yeah, so now I'll request Vinayak sir to talk a little on some of the branches over here. So Vinayak sir, you have the students with you. Please go on.
Yeah, so good evening all of you. This is Vinayak Kulkarni. And in this team of Agarwal Education Center, I basically take mathematics for all the four semesters that you have. And I myself, I'm from the mechanical background. So I'm sure all of you must have definitely done the research on which type of engineering you want to do. But still, in short, I would like to explain. Basically, civil, electrical, and mechanical. These are the core branches, okay, of which I'm going to speak on. Civil, electrical, and mechanical. And it is said that those are the undying branches. But nowadays, we have seen that there is a growing trend towards taking computer, IT, electronics, EXTC, and all those things. So, but civil engineering, mechanical engineering, and electrical engineering, these always will remain the core branches of engineering. And I think very few colleges will be having those particular branches. So almost all the colleges will definitely have computer, will have IT, we have electronics, telecommunication. But very few colleges will have civil, mechanical, and electrical. So unless and until you have specific interest in those branches, please do not opt for these branches. If you have specific interest, so yes, I agree that all the branches will have equal scope if you do very well in your engineering. But unless and until you have scope in, unless and until you have interest in those core branches, please do not go for these core branches. Now, this automobile and production, they are the specialized branches of mechanical only. Okay. And again, as I told you, that very few colleges will have automobile and production. So, yes, the course. Now, many of the students, they ask me question that which of the branches is easy, which is tough. It is never like that. I always tell that the branches of engineering are as per the age that you have attained in that particular year, and everything is doable. So no branch is difficult, no branch is simple. Every branch is at the same level only. Yes, but civil, especially mechanical companies are very less nowadays in Mumbai. But if you are ready to move out of Mumbai and out of the country, and if the branches of physics like mechanics, heat, you know, and all these things fascinate you, okay, electricity, then these are the good branches for all of you. And all these three branches, civil and mechanical especially, they will have drawing, the engineering drawing requirement in all the years of engineering, all the 4 years of engineering, the drawing aspect will be there. So keep all these things in mind and then decide whether to go for civil, mechanical, and electrical.
So, yes, should I take off?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. So, guys, just a minute. Okay. So, basically, guys, in civil engineering, you will get to study things which are related to infrastructure, like roads, buildings, and so on. In mechanical automobile production, you will get to study things about heavy machinery, motors, and so on. Then in chemical engineering, it's all about chemical processes. Okay, that means what process is involved in the production of various chemicals. In electrical engineering, it's all about generation of electricity, its transmission, and so on. Then ETRX stands for electronics. So in ETRX, you'll basically study about the working, about the fundamentals of all the electronic devices. EXTC is a specialized branch. It's a specialized branch of, it's a specialized branch of EXTC, which stands for electronics and telecommunication. So this will deal more with the telecommunication part with it of it, like the mobile communication, TV communication, and so on. the subjects in first 2 years of ETRX and first 2 years of EXTC are common. They are common. All right. After that, in the last 2 years, EXTC will have some special subjects. If you talk about instrumentation, instrumentation is basically a specialized branch again of ETRX. But in instrumentation, you will especially study about instruments. Now, you may ask me which instruments. So there are many instruments which are used in the real world. Okay. So if you take a simple example, take example of speedometer, which is used to measure your car speed. Take example of digital thermometers and so on. So basically, in instrumentation, you will study about these instruments in great detail. Now, if you're confused between ETRX and EXTC, then my advice will be that go for ETRX. That means always go for a broader branch. You can always do your BE, bachelor's in ETRX, and then you can do a specialization in EXTC. All right, but not vice versa. If you talk about comms and IT, okay, so I am a computer engineer. So in comms and IT, basically you will be studying about development of softwares. So your main purpose, your main work over here will be to study programming. So you'll be studying many programming languages like C, Java, Python, and so on. And you'll be studying many fundamental concepts which are utilized in programming, like artificial intelligence, database, and so on. Now guys, the thing is, many students have a very, very, very big misconception, and they believe that the branch of IT is inferior to the branch of computers. Guys, let me tell you one thing, that comm and IT both are exactly same. Okay, look at this thing. Whenever this comes, it is very important. There is no difference between them. They are exactly same. Why is this so important? So listen to me very carefully. Now, as I told you, many students have this misconception that comp and IT, they are exactly same. I'll just revisit it again. Many students have a misconception that IT is inferior to comps. This is what students believe. Now, because of this belief, what happens is, There are many good colleges in which the IT seats will be vacant and the comm seats will be filled up. So guys, if you want to take computer engineering, but if you get IT into a better college, then go for IT in a better college. And trust me, you will never ever regret your decision. After 4 years, you'll come and you will thank me. When companies come for placements, they do not make a distinction between comms and IT. They are exactly same. Okay. Now, moving ahead. So guys, over here, we just give a very, very brief, very quick, kind of introduction about all the branches. So some of you must be wondering that why we were so brief about these branches. So let me tell you one thing, guys. A seminar as short as this, this is a short seminar, not a long one, actually. A seminar as short as this, in this seminar, it is very difficult to explain you about these branches in great detail. My advice to you will be to do two things. What two things? The first thing is that go to YouTube. Okay. Just type over there civil engineering, computer engineering, whatever you want. And you will get many, many, many videos which will explain you nicely about these branches in great detail. Watch those videos and you will get a good idea about them. The second thing which you should do is you should talk to people. You should talk to people who are in that particular field. So let's say you want to take civil engineering. So what you should do is you should talk to somebody who is a civil engineer who is still working in his own field. And you should talk about what kind of work he is doing. Is he happy with his work? What kind of salary he is getting and other things. So after you talk to people, you will come to know that whether this branch is suited to you or not. Sorry. Now, having said that, now let's move ahead. Now, remember one thing, that your branch is more important than your college. Yes. Okay. So what happens is many a time students ask us which is the best branch. So as Vinayak sir rightly told you over here that there's nothing like best branch. Okay. You should see what you are interested in it and accordingly you should choose the college. Now I'll tell you something about Vivekananda College. See what happens, Vivekananda is a very good college with a very good placement record. Vivekananda is in Chembur. Now many students want to take computers or IT in Vivekananda, but they don't get computers or IT in Vivekananda. Now Vivekananda also has a branch called instrumentation. Okay, so what happens is always in all the years what happens is that in this instrumentation branch seats are always vacant. The cutoff is very 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 low. So many students what they do is because it is Vivekananda College they take this instrumentation branch. But after doing 2 years of instrumentation, they repent, they regret their decision. Okay. After doing 2 years of instrumentation, they come to know that this was not a good idea. So guys, that's why I'm telling you that select your branch first. Okay. And don't leave that branch for a good college. Although you may do some trade-offs between comp and IT, or between let's say electronics and EXTC because they are related branches. Okay, but you should never jump to something like instrumentation when you wanted computers. You should not do that. All right, having said that, now now we enter the last phase of our discussion. Okay, in just 10 more minutes our webinar will be over, and what I'm going to tell you in these last 10-15 minutes, it is going to be the most important part of our webinar. This is something which nobody will tell you, but trust me, it is very important. So now guys, this is you. Okay, this is you. All right, you are very happy because you got admission into some particular college of your choice, into some particular branch of your choice. So a big applause to you. Now, one thing which I want to tell you over here is that if you're still with me, I want you all to read this loudly, although I will not be able to hear you. So, getting into engineering is not difficult. Engineering is difficult. And the real battle starts now. Yes, guys, that's true. As I've been telling you right from the beginning that it is not difficult to get into engineering. But engineering itself is difficult. The real battle will start after you get into engineering. Now, why do I say this? So let's understand this. Now, once you get into engineering, let's see what all burden you're going to carry. So first of all, you will have burden of studying 6 subjects: engineering mechanics, BEE, engineering mathematics, engineering physics and engineering chemistry. By the way, BEE is an electrical subject, basics of electrical engineering. Then engineering physics, engineering chemistry. Then you have workshop where you are supposed to do jobs of carpentry, filing, and so on and so on. All right. Now, so the first thing is that the moment you enter engineering, you will have this pressure of studying these 6 subjects. But apart from studying these 6 subjects, okay, there are many other things which I want you to understand over here. Now, what many other things? Just give me a moment. Yeah. So first of all, in engineering colleges, 75% attendance is compulsory. I know that we are currently into a lockdown and things will be online for the first 1 or 2 months. But I believe after 2 or 3 months, you'll have to go to your college. And that time, 75% attendance will be compulsory. It's not like your 12th standard where you don't need to go to your college at all. Okay. Then if you are in engineering, then regularly you will be given some assignments. Okay. Now, if you have an elder brother or elder sister, ask them what is this assignment. And assignment is something which will terrify you a lot. Okay. So basically you will be given many assignments by your teachers and you will have to do lots and lots and lots of writing work. apart from that, you will have T1 and T2. That means unit test 1 and unit test 2. Okay. Then you will have your journals. Then you will have a very short semester. So your semester will start around 15th of December. Currently, they are telling you 1st of December, but I'm pretty sure it will not start on 1st. It will not. It will start not before 15th. In fact, it could be even 1st January. And this semester will be till 15th of March. So you will get hardly 3 months. Okay. Then apart from that, add to it the long traveling hours. So guys, let's say you live in Borivali and you get into DJ Sanghvi College. So you will have to travel minimum 1 hour, 15 minutes each way. Okay. So that will be, 2 hours, 30 minutes. After that, these are basically the factors because of which engineering is going to become very difficult for you. Now, the question is, what is the result of all this? What is the result of all this? The 75% attendance, short semester and all this. So the result of all this is this. Did you observe what happened? It is this. That means the student gets shaken. It directly affects his or her performance. And the student who never got below 90% in his entire career, that student ends up getting an ATKT. By the way, if you fail a particular subject in engineering, we say that you got a KT or you got an ATKT. ATKT is the short form of allowed to keep terms. Okay, so basically ATKT means failing a subject. Now, in my entire career of 15, 16 years, I have seen many students who, as I told you, who were very bright students. They have never achieved less than 95% in their entire life. And suddenly in engineering, they get ATKT. Now, parents often wonder that why this happened. So to understand this, we need to understand that how an engineering student spends his day. So it's interesting. Pay good attention to this. So what will happen is, you will have to attend 8 hours in your college. Okay. Then you will have to give at least 3 hours for traveling or minimum 2 hours for traveling. Then there you have 10 hours for other work. When I say other work, I mean, let's say 7 to 8 hours of sleeping. Okay. Then 1 hour for bathing, brushing your teeth. Okay. Then 1 hour for your internet and so on. All right. So that way, let's say 10 hours for other work. So 8 + 3 = 11 + 10 = 21. So you are left only with 3 hours for studying. Now, the first thing which I want you to understand is, please pay good attention. This 8 hour of college, which you see over here, this is a sheer waste of time. Yes, once again, okay, it may sound as an exaggeration and some of you may even get annoyed at me saying this. But trust me, it is a sheer waste of time. Now, why do I say it is a waste of time? Because you are supposed to have 75% attendance, which means that you will have to go to college every day. But what will happen is that you will sit for your college lecture, but the teaching in your college will be pathetic. You will not understand anything. Okay. I know some of you may not believe me, but as I told you earlier, you will believe me in the next 2 months. So in these eight hours, you are not going to gain any knowledge. It will be a sheer waste of time. So now, if this is a waste of time, okay, let's talk about this 3 hour of study. Now this, when you talk about this 3 hour of study, okay, this 3 hour of study is not like your 12th standard. Okay, so in your 12th standard, you had time to study things seriously. Now, when I say 3 hours of studies over here, study over here means writing assignments. Studying over here means completing journals, okay? Or studying over here means basically, 1 minute. Studying over here basically means finding people who have already completed their assignments and then copying assignments from them. So this is basically 3 hours of study. This is not the actual study which you must be thinking. Okay. So now let's compare all this with your 12th standard. If you compare all this with your 12th standard, now you don't need to tell me anything. Just do a quick comparison in your mind and just see for yourself, in your 12th standard, did you go for an 8-hour college every day? Did you do the 3-hour traveling? Okay, no. So because of this, you got lots and lots and lots of time to do the actual studying. This is not going to happen in engineering, because of which many of you may get a KT. All right, I'm sorry for saying this, but you need to be serious. You need to start planning things properly. Anyway, now I hope you are not amongst one of them. I hope you pass with flying colors. What happens is, moving further, just a minute, guys. Okay, so moving further, what happens is, now many students in engineering, just a second, guys, 1 minute. All right, sorry for that interruption. So what I was saying is that many students in engineering become a part of a vicious cycle. Now, what exactly this vicious cycle is? So pay good attention over here. Okay, we are almost towards the very end. See, what will happen is, you will have your semester one exam in March. Okay, I hope you know that in engineering, you will have two semesters. In semester one, you will have subjects, maths, mechanics, PWE, physics, chemistry workshop. In semester two, you will have maths, C programming, you will have engineering graphics, you will have physics, chemistry. You will have a subject which will be similar to English, which is called PCE, professional ethics and communication. And you will also have workshop. So 5 subjects in sem one and 6 subjects in semester two. Okay. Semester one, under normal circumstances, not this year, under normal circumstances, semester one starts in August and it ends in November end. Okay. And semester two is from January till April 15. Okay. But this time you will have even a shorter semester. So your semester one will start, let's say, not before 15th of December. And you will have your semester one exam in mid-March. That means only 3 months. Now, it is quite possible that some of you, you will get your semester one result in the month of May. And it is quite possible that some of you may fail one or two subjects in your sem one. Now, if you fail, no problem. You're still allowed to move further. No problem. So now what will happen is, when you are in sem two, when you're in semester two, you will have subjects of semester two. And you will also have your backlog of semester one. Backlog means the subjects in which you have failed. Now, semester two exams will be in June. Okay, it will be around 15th of June for you guys. Normally, it starts around 10th of May. But I think for you guys, it will be 15th of June. Now, again, you will have a short semester, which will start, let's say on 1st of April. So April, May, and 15th June, your exams may start. Again, a very short semester. So again, what will happen is, or what may happen is, that you may clear the subject of semester one, but you may get a new KT of semester two. And that becomes a vicious cycle. Now, why I call it a cycle? Because the same thing will continue in semester three. So when you're in semester three, you may get a KT in a subject of semester three, you will clear semester two, and that continue further. So guys, never ever enter this vicious cycle for a reason. Now, whatever is going to come in front of you, listen to this, read this very carefully, and that is this thing. Please understand one thing, simply passing engineering is not enough. I repeat, sorry, simply passing engineering is not enough. Passing it with good grades is required. Yes, that's true. See, what happens is, many students, listen to me carefully, many students who have done engineering will come and tell you, ke yaar, engineering karne ka koi fayda hi nahi hai, because after I did my engineering and I don't have any jobs after doing 4 years of engineering. The moment he says this, ask him what is his percentage, what is his result in his 4 years, in his 8 semesters. And I'm very sure this student who complains of no jobs, okay, you will see that he has fared very badly in his 4 years of engineering. Okay, he has got multiple KTs. He probably never got beyond 50%. So guys, if you are simply passing engineering with many 80 KTs and with a very poor score, you will obviously not get a good job, or I will say you will not even get a job. So that is why passing it with good grades is important. Okay, so remember this thing. If you're not serious about engineering, okay. So for example, you know, I have come across many students, or let me tell you something about your parents. All right, this is going to be interesting. I'll tell you something about your parents. See, parents, na, they always lay a trap for their children. So what parents often tell their children, ke beta, 10 standard pass kar le, uske baad to bas maze hi maze karne. Now, after you pass 10 standard, your parents will tell you, beta, 12th standard pass kar le, uske baad to maze hi maze hai. Engineering mein to bas maze hi karne hai. Okay? And you are that poor, innocent guy who keeps on believing your parent. But the real truth is, ke ye maze karne kabhi bhi tumko nahi milenge. When you come to engineering, there also you have to work very, very, very hard. As I told you, getting into engineering is not difficult. Engineering is difficult. So guys, if you are coming to engineering with this mindset that I'm coming to engineering just because I want to have fun, okay, then my strong advice to you will be, don't do engineering. Don't waste your time and your parents' money. There are many other fields. And if you decide to do engineering, okay, you should get very good marks. Finally, I will tell you that if you, as I told you, that coaching, teaching in engineering colleges is very bad. And if you ever need professional help, okay, then remember one thing, that students often go for coaching for 3 subjects in each semester. So in semester 1, students take coaching for mechanics, maths, BEE. And in semester 2, they take coaching for C programming, maths, and engineering graphics. Okay. You don't need coaching for physics, chemistry, and other subjects. Now, Agarwal Education Center, I'm a part of Agarwal Education Center. So Agarwal Education Center of Borivali is a very prominent name for degree engineering coaching. We have been teaching almost, not almost, all of us, we have been teaching engineering students since past many, many years. Like I have experience of 15 years, Ram Kumar sir has experience of 30 years, and so on. So guys, do consider Agarwal Education Center if you want coaching. And my advice to you will be that if you're joining multiple subjects, then don't join multiple subjects at different places. There are 2 reasons for that. One reason is that if you join different subjects at different places, then very often there will be clash in the lecture timings of 2 different teachers. Whereas if you join all the subjects in our institute, you will never have this clash of lecture timings. And apart from that, if you join all the subjects in our classes, you will get huge discounts also. So many a times what the student does is, first he will join one subject. After 10 days, he will join second subject. After 10 days, he will join all the subjects of semester 1 and semester 2. So my advice is that join subjects of sem 1 as well as SEM 2 right in the beginning and get huge package discounts. Okay. So once again, this is the pamphlet. You can see our phone numbers over here. So see, right in the very bottom over here, right in the very bottom over here, these are our phone numbers. You can call us if you have any query about coaching classes, or you can even call us if you have any query about the degree engineering admission process. Okay. So I suggest you take a screenshot of this if you haven't taken. I'll wait for a few seconds. So guys, that's it. I thank you very much for staying with me. This is my website, sandeepgupta.org. Please note down this website, because after the DTE will release all its documents, I will upload these documents on my site also. So downloading it from my side will be easier for you. So I thank you very much for staying with me. In case you have any queries, you can call us, and our phone numbers are given in the pamphlet. Unfortunately, the seminar went on for a longer time than expected. This is the first time I'm taking a degree engineering admission seminar via Zoom. So it probably took a little longer. Normally it takes 1 hour, 30 minutes. I was planning to answer your queries over Zoom, but it's too late right now to do that. So guys, what you can do is, if you have any queries about degree engineering admission process, you can call us without any reluctance, without any hesitation, and we'll be glad to help you. Okay. So I stop here today. Thank you very much. Bye. Good night.